It is Friday, finally. It is the end of week 9, finally. 3 more lectures after today. So I'm finishing the term with a set of lectures that I have not given to this class before, some changes that I've decided to make. And I hope that you find the topics I've picked to talk about to be of interest. I was talking about epigenetics last time and getting really started just barely on that. And before I dive into that too much, I want to say a little bit about a very interesting observation that's been made. And I'm going to tie it into some epigenetic considerations today. So the observation is one that you might have heard of before. And the observation is known as the caloric restriction observation. And the caloric restriction observation has been known for over 100 years. The observation is this. If you take animals and you put them on a diet where they have a minimal amount of calories necessary to survive, and you provide the necessary vitamins and so forth in that diet, but they're on basically a pretty low-calorie diet, their life expectancy extends by up to about 30%. And there's a lot of interest, and there has been a lot of interest in this thing for many years. And in recent years, the interest in this has been increasing because we think, well, there's a sort of a capacity that organisms seem to have to extend their life expectancy beyond what they would normally live to. And so there's a lot of ideas and thoughts about how that phenomenon occurs. And the one that people keep coming back to is relating to reproduction. So the thinking is that if an organism is starving, and particularly if it's starving before it goes through puberty, that that would not be in the interest of the survival of the organism, not the individual organism, but the species as a whole, if it can't reproduce. And so the thinking is that the organisms have evolved a system that's a sort of a backup system that allows them to go into a low metabolic mode where they are burning less energy, burning more of their fat or whatever fat reserves that they have, and delaying a lot of things, including puberty and reproductive events, so that they can survive until food is available, and then they can reproduce. And so as a consequence of that, these organisms that are having this phenomenon live longer. And the thinking is that humans probably have this as well. There are actually people on caloric-restricted diets right now. But the problem is it takes a human lifespan to determine if you've actually lived longer or not. So we don't know the answer to that question. But that's the thinking that's associated with this. And as I said, there's probably some very good reasons why that happens. And we see examples of it, for example, in young women who have anorexia, frequently stop menstruating, or athletes that are on a high protein diet that aren't have low body fat, for example. Will often stop menstruating. And so the thinking is that perhaps that idea is right, and perhaps that idea actually holds in humans. Now, I want to plant that idea in your head to start today's lecture, because it relates to some things I'm going to talk about with respect to epigenetics. So epigenetics, I haven't really defined the term, and I want to spend a minute doing that. I started showing you how, for example, it was that histones could be modified. And histone modification turns out to be a central component of the phenomenon we refer to as epigenetics. So let me tell you a little bit about what epigenetics is. Epigenetics means literally apart from genetics. That's what the term relates to. And epigenetics is an area of investigation that has become very significant and very much appreciated in the past 20 years. Prior to that time, there was a lot of thinking that the only things that we saw that happened in organisms were the result of inheritance that happened through the coding of DNA. And epigenetics, because of its name, saying apart from genetics, suggests that there's something more to inheritance and traits that are present other than the simple coding that's found in DNA. So that's really what the root of epigenetics is all about. Well, how is it that we could have information that could be passed from one generation to another that would not be coded in the DNA. We know, of course, mutation happens, but mutation from one generation to the other is generally not significant. And so we wouldn't expect that we would see some of those phenomena that occur. And the phenomena that we see occur are adaptive phenomena. Adaptive. I'm going to show you a study in just a little bit of adaptations that happened from one generation to another. And we know that there were not significant DNA changes that made those observations. Okay? So there had to be something else that was making those adaptations possible and inherited from one generation to the other. Well, it turns out, of course, that there is information that can be passed from one generation to another apart from the sequence of DNA when that occurs in the form of modifications of histones. So when I've started talking about the fact that these histones can be modified and those modifications of those histones can change transcriptional properties, okay, then some of those modifications can survive the process of reproduction, meaning that they're passed from one generation to the next. They're not part of the coding of the DNA, but they're part of the modifications of the sequences of the DNA. We'll see how DNA can be methylated, for example. And you've already seen how histones can have modifications that occur to them that affect transcription. Well, if you start affecting transcription and you pass along, for example, from one generation to the next, those changes in transcription, the generation that gets those will inherit, okay, a tendency to make genes in a certain way that perhaps their parents had acquired during their reproductive lifetime. So this is a really exciting, really interesting area. We're still uncovering a lot of things relevant to our understanding of epigenetics. So I want to start here with an observation that was made actually back in, of some people in Sweden starting back over 100 years ago. And they had excellent records of these people. I think there was about 2,000 of them. Is the number up there? No, the number's not up there. It's about 2,000 people. And this spanned three generations of people in Sweden. And the three generations of people in Sweden, I believe it was the very first generation that experienced during their growing up years, during their time when they were getting ready to go through puberty or before they went through puberty, they had a famine. So there was a starvation phenomenon that occurred. They had to basically follow, they basically had to survive this, and they did. So of course, as we follow generations, we're following people who have survived and so forth. So this was known as, and I don't even know how you pronounce that word, I'm gonna say overcalix, and that's probably not a proper Swedish pronunciation, but that's my dumb English, or my dumb American way of saying that. But what they found was that there were some properties that were transmitted from one generation to the next. And this is only one study. There are many studies, for example, that show effects of smoking that can affect two generations forward. Okay? And there's one smoking thing in this observation as well. But I want to just sort of step you through it. So when they followed these people and the children and the grandchildren that they had, they found that some of these things went all the way through down to grandchildren. And what they saw was, first of all, that if there were fathers who began smoking early, that the sons of those had a higher body mass index. They were more obese, okay, but not the daughters. All right? Now, I don't have a good explanation for that one, but it was an observation. Okay? And it was quite clearly statistically significant. It quite clearly was happening. And it quite clearly was somehow being transmitted through two generations. Now, the second two observations are a little bit more interesting for our perspective. And they relate to the grandmothers, okay, that is the first generation, the ones who went through this famine period, okay. The grandmothers, if their food supply was linked to what's called the mortality risk ratio. Basically, if the grandmother had gone through a famine period, and not all the people in this had. They had people who had and people who had not. Okay, the grandmother had gone through the famine period. Okay, the likelihood of her granddaughter, okay, living longer was greater. Now, this is, if we think about this, a little consistent with the idea I told you, that the grandmother goes through this famine period, her DNA gets modified, and I don't know how long the grandmother lived. That's the common question I get. I don't know the answer to that question. But the grandmother's DNA and or the grandmother's histones got modified to allow her and her progeny. If we think about this, this sort of makes sense. If you are starving, the likelihood that your child will also starve or have low food conditions is high. So transmitting this information from one generation to the next makes a lot of good sense, right? Well, the daughters had a greater likelihood of living, okay, if grandma had gone through this. And if grandma had plenty of food to eat, they were actually more at risk for dying, because if you think about this biologically, you can have kids. There's no problem with making everything that you need to have kids. And as far as nature's concerned, once you've had your kids, we don't care about you anymore, right? Okay, the same thing happened with the sons, okay, I'm sorry, with the grandfather's sons, okay? The grandfather's grandsons, I shouldn't say sons, grandfather's grandsons had exactly the same phenomenon, okay? So the grandfather's food supply is only linked to the mortality of the grandsons. The grandmother's food supply was only linked with the granddaughters. And in both cases, their life expectancy was extended. Yes? I don't know about the generation we're skipping. I don't know that. Yep. Okay? But now this idea that this starvation might be helping in some way, and this not only might be helping an individual, which is the way I explained it to you, but also being passed on to progeny and down a couple of generations, is a pretty remarkable thing. Okay? So what I want to do now is step back and look again at some of the epigenetic and the modifications of the histones that I've talked about, and think about how this might play out. And I want to tie something else into that that I think is kind of interesting. Okay. So, last time, this isn't the one I want, last time I talked about these modifications. And as I said, there are a bunch of modifications. There are a bunch of things that can happen to the tails of those histones that are hanging off of the nucleosome. And those modifications have effects. Now, I talked about how making acetylation, for example, we could imagine that we would neutralize the negative charge. We would the positive charge. There I go doing it again. Neutralize the positive charge of the histone so that the complex sort of relaxes and allows more transcription to occur. And we could also imagine that deacetylation, removing those acetyl groups, would now make for the histone to have a more positive charge, a tighter grip on the DNA, and less access of the transcriptional machinery for transcribing. So we have increased transcription, we have decreased transcription. Okay. As I said, it's not a simple picture, because as we look at the modifications that happen to histones, we see not only acetylation, but we also see methylation, and we see methylation that can happen multiple times on a given lysine, for example, on a histone. And in some cases, those are activating, and in other cases, those are repressing. So it's not a simple picture. We can't just say you put this group on there and this is what happens, but we have to know what group was put on, we have to know how many of those groups were put on, and in some cases, we actually see activation, in other cases, we see repression, and that may relate to individual genes. Okay, so this may come down to individual gene level, not just a broad spectrum of all genes. So my point in showing you this isn't to confuse you. My point of this isn't to get you to memorize all these, but rather to recognize that modifications of these histones do have effects on transcription. And we could imagine that those modifications, if they're carried forward in generations, will also have the effects in the progeny and the further future offspring of those individuals. It turns out that those modifications do, in fact, carry forward. They carry forward through the gametes, And when those DNAs are reproduced, and when those histones are made for those DNAs that are reproduced, they tend to keep those modifications. Do they keep them forever? No, they don't. But for a generation or two, they appear that they can be, in many cases, stable. So this idea that epigenetic changes can be transmitted is a valid one, and that the effects that they have on transcription, we can imagine how those will manifest themselves in longevity and things like that. I want to talk about histone acetylation to start with, because that's the simplest one for us to think about. Histone acetylation favors, euchromatin. Euchromatin is the relaxed form of chromatin, and that's consistent with what I told you before. We're covering up those positive charges. The hold that the histones have on that DNA is relaxed, and transcription can occur. Histone deacetylation has the opposite effect. And enzymes that catalyze that are known as histone deacetylases, or as what people call HDACs, HDACs. All right? Histone deacetylases reverse the effects. They favor the formation of heterochromatin, tightly packed DNA protein complexes, and less access to transcription. Okay. When we look at the deacetylases that are found in our cells, there's a group of them known as the sirtuins. And the relevant one for humans is called sirtuin 1. In lower organisms, it's called sirtu, but it's essentially the same thing. Sirtu is a histone deacetylase, okay? And you see on here it says it's downregulated with insulin resistance, okay? It turns out that when we look at organisms that are organisms that have some repression of the expression of SIRT2, that's the lower organisms, what we find is they live longer. The organisms live longer. Somehow turning off, the acetylation making for heterochromatin is associated with longevity. It's associated with longevity. Now, I don't pose this out here for you to understand transmission from one generation to another, because if we're modifying those histones, that's not going to go from one generation to another. But within an individual, we start to understand, perhaps, how it is that longevity is actually resulting. This making of the heterochromatin, the turning off of broad classes of genes, appears to be associated with longevity. And there's a lot of interest right now in these sets of genes because of this observation that people have made. Now, there are some confusing components to it. I'm not going to talk about those confusing components today. But we start seeing how modifications of the histones, may have some effect on our lifespan. Very, very important observation. Okay. Insulin resistance is not good for an organism. We think about this associated with diabetes, and we all know that diabetes, of course, is not a good prescription for longevity. The sirtuins appear to affect genes related to the breakdown of fat. In fact, when they're expressed, they stimulate the breakdown of fat. Now think about those starving organisms. Think about those organisms that are on a low-cal diet. Are they going to need to break down fat to stay alive? You betcha. And again, this is consistent with their ability to survive this over a longer period of time so that they can get to a point where they've got food and then they can reproduce. Okay? Pretty exciting, interesting work. There are people here at OSU, Dr. Tori Hagen, who work on the molecular basis of aging, who work not with these specific proteins, but things related to these proteins, and are finding some fascinating things about longevity. So it's a really, really exciting time. So these kinds of phenomena are very relevant, not only for us as individuals, but also for our kids, our grandkids, and so forth. All right. Well. Having said that, and having tantalized you with that, I'll back up and talk about some of the more pedestrian aspects of histone modification. Okay? As I pointed out before, you can have methylation that can occur, and if you have methylation occurring, you can also have demethylation occurring, acetylation, deacetylation. All of these things are reversible, and as I noted, that when we transmit things from one generation to the next, that doesn't mean that they're transmitted forever. So these effects have a limited, I don't say lifespan, a limited evolutionary component, but they do appear to cross, in many cases, the generational boundary. Phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. If we think about phosphorylating the histones, we could imagine we could have a pretty big effect on them because they're starting out positive. And if we phosphorylate them, we're making them negative. So we could imagine some very big changes in dynamics with respect to the interaction with DNA. Ubiquitination, which is the placing of a ubiquitin molecule onto individual histones. I won't talk about that. And the other thing with respect to epigenetic changes, these are all epigenetic changes I'm talking about. Okay? The other thing with respect to epigenetic changes involves actual methylation of DNA. Okay? So DNA itself gets methylated, and the methylation of DNA can be transmitted across generations as well. So let me say a word for a minute about methylation. DNA methylation has the following primary effect. It affects the binding of proteins to a sequence that they normally recognize. The methylation that happens in eukaryotic cells is on cytosine residues. And you see that listed here. Specifically, there's cytosines that are immediately followed by a G. They're called CpG residues because P refers to the phosphate between the individual nucleotides. All right? You can see below that methylation has happened on this sequence, and you can see, as I've indicated on the screen, no transcription is occurring of that gene. Well, from what I've told you, I would hope that you would have a pretty good idea about why no transcription of that gene would be occurring. We remember that in the case of eukaryotic cells, transcription factors are very important for binding to the control regions ahead of the actual gene. And so if we interfere with the binding of those transcription factors by putting methyl groups on the Cs, we could imagine that transcription could be turned off. Well, imagine I've got a gene that has some important function, but it gets turned off in my generation, and I transmit that to my kids, okay? They're not going to express that gene either, whereas my friend over here who doesn't have that gene methylated is making that gene, transmits onto his or her kids an unmethylated gene, they're going to be making it as well. So there'd be a difference that would happen between us as a result of that. But that difference might relate to survivability ultimately, right, over evolutionary time. And so we might see that the ability to adapt to the environment based on the ability to methylate or unmethylate genes might give an advantage to one or other, depending upon whether that was advantageous to make the gene or not. Well, I point this thing out here, and I want to remind you, because I'm going to show you something in a minute that's going to be a little confusing to you, but I point this out to you so that you recognize that the critical thing that gets blocked is the binding of DNA, binding of DNA by proteins. That's the critical component in methylation of DNA. In this case, we see that the transcription of this gene is turned off. I'm going to show you one in a bit that's going to be confusing to you at first, because you're going to see that methylation affects transcription and actually turning it on. Okay? But the key difference is because we're talking about the binding of proteins to DNA, not just the expression of the gene. Is that clear? So remember that we're talking about that. Okay, let's see, what else? Oh, I like this one. This, again, illustrates the four histones. And look at the modifications that can happen along the tails. In this case, we see two tails because we have a carboxyl end and an amino end, whereas these up here, we only have the amino ends that stick out. But look at that. Isn't that just remarkable, the different things that can happen and the effects it can have on whether transcription is enhanced or repressed? The modifications themselves, I talked about methylation, and so I decided I wanted to show you a little bit about what methylation looked like. Here's a side chain of arginine with its dual amines that we can see as shown here in the resonance structure. We can methylate arginine, and if we put a methyl group on there, we see something like this. If we put two methyl groups on there, we can either put them on like we see here, one there and one there. That's known as asymmetric because they're both going on the same nitrogen. Or we can see them symmetric where we get one on each nitrogen. So we see there's a variety of methylations that can happen, and some of these very subtle differences really relate to whether the gene is turned on or turned off. Okay. Oh, I did that. Let's go back here. Okay. Well, keep in mind what I just told you about the methylation, because it's going to come up in a couple of slides as relevant. To get to that couple of slides, though, I need to say a little bit about what's happening with enhancers. So enhancers, you remember, are DNA sequences that are control sequences that are found in eukaryotic cells. And they're not close to the promoter. They're thousands of base pairs away in many cases. And these enhancer sequences are bound by proteins called transcriptional activators. Okay? Transcriptional activators. These transcriptional activators bind to that sequence, and even though they're thousands of base pairs away, they can affect transcription when the DNA bends, as you see here. The bending of the DNA can bring into close proximity sequences that are not close to each other physically, or in a primary sequence, but can be physically brought close together by the bending action itself. So in this case, we see that the enhancer, which is bound here, has been brought into close proximity with the promoter and the gene down here by the bending. And so we actually see some interactions that are happening between the transcription factors, which are the darker blue, and the transcriptional activator, which is the lighter blue. So that bending facilitates this. And when people discovered this, they thought, ah, that makes sense. Because prior to realizing this, nobody could quite figure out why or how it was that these enhancer sequences so far away from a gene could have an effect. Okay. In this slide, we can see the same thing sort of depicted in a little bit more detail. And I want to just kind of step you through that. So on the very top, we have enhancers that have been bound by activator proteins. We can see the bending that has happened in the DNA to bring this enhancer sequence close to the control region, the promoter, where the gene is actually going to be transcribed. We can see the transcription complex, which I've talked about before, which includes the TF2D and other proteins like that, that help the RNA polymerase to bind. So somehow this enhancer helps to build this transcriptional complex. And it's in that way that the enhancer actually enhances transcription of this gene that's located a few thousand bases away from it. Okay? It's a pretty interesting phenomenon. And we know now that this sort of complex of complexes actually does occur. And transcription is facilitated as a result of that. Okay? Now, there are also sequences that are present that I haven't told you about called insulators. And insulators are sequences that can be thousands of base pairs away that have the opposite effect. They turn off transcription. And how do they do that? Well, the insulators can bind to protein. This thing called the CCCTC is a protein that, if it binds to an insulator, can actually interfere with the assembly of this complex. So the insulator is a DNA sequence that's binding a protein, in this case called CTCF. This is a longer name for part of the component of it. But CTCF that's binding to the insulator. Binding of this to the insulator interferes with the assembly of this complex and therefore interferes with the transcription of that gene. Where's the confusion? Well, the confusion is that methylation of the insulator favors transcription. Why does it favor transcription? Because it interferes with the binding of the CTCF to that sequence. And if the CTCF can't bind to that sequence, it can't interfere with transcription, and transcription can occur. So the key, as I said, is the methylation interferes with the binding of a protein to a DNA. In this case, the protein that's binding to the DNA needs to bind to the DNA to turn off transcription. It can't do that. Okay. Yeah, question. Yeah. It is a silencer. Yes. Uh-huh. Okay. So we can see this overall thing here. Now, these aren't necessarily, I mean, these can be located in quite a variety of places, so they don't have to be adjacent as it looks like they are here. They don't have to be ahead of, that is, 5 prime to the start site. They can be 3 prime, like this guy is here. The enhancer could be out here as well. All that the enhancer has to be is close enough that the DNA can bend back to it and start the transcription of the appropriate gene. And that's a nice shot of the bending. There are things known as bending proteins, amazingly enough, that help facilitate the bending to bring those sequences into close proximity with each other. Okay. I'm going to talk about 2 more things relevant to control of gene expression. And you start to get the idea that gene expression in eukaryotic cells is very, very complicated. And it is location dependent upon where these things are occurring in the chromosomes. I want to step and look at a specific gene system that's very interesting, and this relates to the cell's management of iron. Iron is a very critical thing for cells. If we look at microorganisms in the ocean, for example, iron is a limiting nutrient. They scavenge and scavenge and scavenge to get iron because iron in many places is very limiting in the ocean waters, and it can be a limiting factor in how fast they grow. Our cells also scavenge and hold on to iron. They have stores of iron that they keep because we need iron for things like hemoglobin. We need iron for making things like hemes for the electron transport system, for example, and being able to scavenge and hold on to iron is important. Another thing about iron is iron can be contributing to making reactive oxygen species if it's not sequestered. So keeping the iron sequestered is important, and that's actually part of what I want to talk about here. There are 2 proteins relevant for our consideration for the management of iron. One is called ferritin, and you can see it on the top, and it's a protein that forms a ball, and within that ball, there are something like 1,800 iron atoms that can be held, a large number of iron atoms that this ball can hold and then sort of let out as the cell or the body needs those, okay? So it's just a backup of iron that's there, and it's also keeping these irons from causing reactive oxygen species to form because all the irons are sequestered inside of this ball, okay? The other is something called the transferrin receptor. The transferrin receptor is a protein that's found in the membrane of cells that facilitates the movement of transferrin into the cell. And what transferrin is a protein that carries iron between cells. Okay? So the ferritin is a storage thing within a cell. Transferrin carries iron into the cell, and it gets in there through action of the transferrin receptor. Now, that's really all we need to know to start this. Okay? If we think about the cell's needs, all right, we have the same consideration for iron that bacterial cell had for tryptophan or for lactose or any of that. That is, if the cell has plenty of iron, there's no reason for it to try to get more. If the cell has too much iron, then it wants to sequester it because there's reactive oxygen species that can happen. Are you with me? Low conditions, we want to get it in. High conditions, we want to sequester it. Okay? And we don't want any more coming in, right? Because we got plenty. All right. So understanding that, if we look at the transcriptional controls on these 2 proteins, they're really interesting. They work through something called an iron response element, okay? IRE. This depicts the messenger RNA for ferritin, okay? You see that ferritin forms another one of our favorite stem loops. Okay? By the way, all stem loops are not equal, right? So even though something forms a stem loop, that doesn't mean it has any effect. It only has effect if proteins interact with it and cause things to happen. So we saw, for example, the terminator sequence had an effect on the messenger RNA. But only the terminator sequence. Not all hairpins stopped transcription. But the ones that had a structure that interacted with the messenger, with the RNA polymerase, did have that effect. Okay, well, here's an IRE, and an IRE has a specific structure, and it's recognized by a specific protein. This protein it's recognized by is called IRE-BP, or iron response element binding protein. Iron response element binding protein can bind to the IRE, as you see on the top, and when it does that, it actually stops the ribosome from translating this sequence. The IRE-BP also has a binding site for iron itself. And so if there's plenty of iron in the cell, IRE-BP binds to the iron, and it no longer binds to the IRE. Okay? You with me? So if there's no iron in the cell, we block it, the translation of ferritin. And if there is iron in the cell, we enhance the translation of ferritin. You with me? So we're controlling translation, one of the ways in which we control gene expression. Well, if the cell has plenty of iron, what did I say it wants to do? It wants to sequester it, right? And it sequesters it with what? Ferritin. So when there's plenty of iron, we want the cell to be making ferritin because we want it to grab a hold of that iron and keep it from forming reactive oxygen species. That's what's happening here. When there's no iron, there's no reason for me to be making ferritin because it would be a waste of my energy. There's no iron to put into it, right? So in that case, the IRE-BP binds to this and stops the translation of ferritin. It's a very simple, very beautiful system. Well, this system actually also extends to the transferrin receptor. The transferrin receptor has a little different strategy, though. When we look at the transferrin receptor, here's what a transferrin receptor messenger RNA looks like. It's got an open 5' end. It's got open coding, okay? But at its 3' end, we see it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 iron response elements. Don't confuse the iron response elements with the binding protein. And IRE is that hairpin. The IRE-BP is the protein. Okay? When the structure forms and there's no iron, what happens? The IRE-BP binds to the structure. And when there is iron, the IRE-BP does not bind to the structure, just like before. But the effects are different here. Why is it binding at the 3' end? What did I say about how messenger RNAs were degraded? Does anybody remember? They start at the 3' end, and they move inwards. If I have, at the 3' end, an IRE-BP that's bound, what happens is the nucleases that would start at the 3' end can't get past there. What this is doing, in this case, is stabilizing the messenger RNA and increasing its lifetime. When there's no iron, such as the case here, then the transferrin receptor is made in greater abundance. Think about this. If there's no iron in the cell, does the cell want to get more iron in it? It does. Does it want to have receptor? It does. So this facilitates the movement of iron into cells when there's no iron. However, when there is iron, the IRE-BP binds to the iron, and it can no longer bind to the IRE. Consequently, this message is less stable. The nucleases can go zipping through and break it down. When there's plenty of iron, there's less of the transferrin receptor that's actually made. Question? IRE is the hairpin. So all the hairpin does is it binds to the IRE-BP, right? Okay. But if the IRE-BP is bound to it, the nuclease can't break it down. If the IRE-BP is bound to iron instead, when there's abundant iron in the cell, then the nuclease has its ability to just break that messenger RNA down. So now it really makes sense. When we have high iron, okay, when we have high iron, we start making the ferritin so we can store it at the same time as we stop making the transferrin receptor so we don't bring any more in. And when iron is low, we stop making the ferritin because we don't need it, but we start making the transferrin receptor so that we get more iron in. It's a really slick system. And it's working at a couple of levels. With respect to the ferritin, it was inhibiting translation. Translation was being controlled. When we look at the transferrin receptor, the stability of the messenger RNA is the regulating component. Now, this system is really nice because it shows that control of gene expression can happen through many mechanisms and at many levels. And this is something that's not at all uncommon to happen in eukaryotic cells. Okay. Yes, question. So when the IRE-BP is bound to iron? Okay, hold on. So let's go back and make sure you get it right, okay? So when we look at ferritin, whenever iron is present, IRE-BP will bind to it. That's true whether we're talking about one versus the ferritin or the transferrin receptor. That binding of iron by the IRE-BP is independent of the gene. If iron is present, the IRE-BP will be bound to it. Then the question is, what's the consequences of the binding of iron by the IRE-BP? The consequence in the case of ferritin is that this sequence will no longer be bound by the IRE-BP, and thus translation will happen. When there's no iron, this binds to the IRE and stops translation from happening. Okay? So, in this case, we make the protein. In the case of the transferrin receptor, when there is iron, we stop making the protein. They have opposite effects because of the different mechanisms that are being used. Do you follow? Okay. Okay. It's an important point. Other questions about that? It's a beautiful system. Okay. Well, I've got a few minutes, and it's Friday. How many think I should do some more material? One, two, three. I noticed they didn't raise their hands very high. We can actually cover that next week. I do have a song for you that I think you'll enjoy. It's called Chromatin. Just of the lysine bind to phosphate. Charges cling to pluses tight. Chromatin assembly is essential. Eukaryotic must get it. Cells are tiny micro-scaled enclosures. Nuclei deep in their insides. That's the place of me. Sing the end of that Slow song. 7 feet of DNA resides. Charges, don't forget. Ages 3 and 4, they make up a chromatin course. Downsizing chromosomes. Okay, guys, have a good weekend.